they came to Jericho. As he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great multitude, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the road begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out,
"Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me."
Then many warned him to be quiet, but he cried out all the more,
"Son of David, have mercy on me."
So Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. Then they called the blind man,
"Be of good cheer. Rise, he is calling you."
And throwing aside his garment, he rose and came to Jesus. So Jesus answered and said to him,
"What do you want me to do for you?"
"Rabboni, that I may receive my sight."
"Go your way. Your faith has made you well."
And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus on the road.
Everybody say persistence. Turn to somebody next to you and say, "It takes persistence." Turn my monitors down a little bit. It's ringing up here. Let me tell you what persistence means. It's always fun to look up words that we speak about, even though we somewhat know what they mean. And probably most of us know the meaning, but it's always good to reassure and to read the facts on what persistent means. It means continuing to do something or to try to do something, even though it is difficult or other people want you to stop. Even though it is difficult or other people want you to stop. I want to declare unto you, get a spirit of persistence. A spirit of persistence. Persistence to be a good husband. Persistence to be a good wife. Persistence to be a good parent. A persistence to be a good student. A persistence to be a good worker. A persistence to be excellent in your life. Persistence with your own health. Persistence. Persistence to make more, to achieve more. Remember, continuing to do something or try to do something that even though it's difficult or other people want you to stop, if you are waiting on somebody to give you a free ride, it will never happen. If you're waiting for the day in which it is all going to come together, I want to assure you it will take persistence. It will take something within you that you have got to say, "I can do this, I'm going to do this, I'm declaring." Now, if you want to go biblically correct, the Bible says we are more than conquerors. We declare that we're going to press for the high calling, another scripture, press for the high calling of God. I'm going to be persistent. When you woke up today, God had already planned and said some things to you. He said these words to you: "I will make the world, I will make the sun come up, the sun will go down, the world will turn, I will make sure that you don't fly off, but gravity will keep you pulled to the earth. I will give you the oxygen, I will give you the opportunity, I will make the day, but it is up to you to rejoice." That's 35 of you. Let me stop again. Let's stop for a moment. You didn't have to bring the sun up. Last night while you were sleeping, you didn't have to keep the solar system in place. You don't have to worry about the gravel. You don't have to worry gravity. You don't have to worry about the oceans of Pacific or the Atlantic covering the United States in a tsunami. Last night, the lakes, the Great Lakes, stayed in place. The mountain stayed in place. God has created everything around you. He made it. Quit griping. Quit feeling sorry for yourself. You need to fire up with your persistency and get happy right now about God and what he's done. Turn to somebody and say, "Get happy." When you wake up in the morning, you have got to say, "I'm going to be happy." If you don't want to wake up, we'll bury you this week sometime. You woke up. How many cemeteries did you pass? How many hospitals did you pass? You say, but you don't know what I'm going through. You've got to be persistent enough that regardless of what you're going through in life, it is not going to stop you. It is only temporary. God's got a plan for your life. He woke you up this morning. He wants you to rejoice about it. Come on, everybody, let's provoke ourselves to rejoice and say, this is the day that the Lord has made. Now, these are God's words. These are not men's words. These are not motivation. These are God's words. This is the day that the Lord hath made, and I will be glad in it. I will be glad in it. But you don't know what my husband did to me last week. You don't know what my wife did. You don't know what my boss did. You don't know that I'm in debt. You don't know I've been sick. You don't know the struggle. You don't know about my children. You don't know what I'm going through. It is a requirement by God that if you wake up, you got to stir yourself up. Well, I'm waiting on God to touch me. He's already touched you. He woke you up this morning. Look at you. You're breathing. Your heart is pounding. If you got high blood pressure, you came to the right place to get it lowered. If you got low blood pressure, you came to the right place to get it higher. Because God has strategized and you are on purpose in 2024. Be persistent in all the things that you have in life. Jesus was that way. He gives us a great example. We're about 35 days out. We're celebrating. The cross is above me and we started Lent season. In this season is a season in which we are on a 40-day journey to the resurrection or Easter Sunday. In this period, everybody needs to know, the Bible talks about the sons of Issachar in the Bible. The sons of Issachar, the Bible says, they knew the signs and the times for what Israel ought to do. So the spirit of Issachar is upon me today, and I want to tell you the next 40 days, what's happening in your life and what you're up against and what's going to happen. You are in the last 40 days before Easter, you are still in the double portion. You are still in the double portion of the former and the latter rain. Now, some of you are not clapping your hands because you hadn't got your miracle yet, but you got 40 days to go for the outpouring of the double portion. Then what happens on Easter all the way to atonement will be former, the former rains or the moderate rains. God says, I will bless you moderately. But he says between atonement and Easter, I will give you the former rains and the double portion or the latter rain. So you're in a season, 40 days left. Now there's some miracles that God's got for you, but if you don't get a hold of your persistency, you're going to miss, you're going to abort. And you may say, well, what about faith? Well, when we talk about persistency, it marries our faith to believe for the impossible, to know that God is yet to do what he's promised to do in your life. So now to Easter. Now I'm going to tell you something else. I want to give you a little strategy here. Remember that we are not to be ignorant of the devil's devices. Turn to somebody and say, don't be dumb about the devil. Say, don't be dumb about the devil. I didn't say they were the devil. I said, don't be dumb about the devil. I saw a husband or a wife right there just kind of. Here's the key. The key is the devil hates this season. He hates the cross. He hates what happened in this season. He had no idea this was going to happen 2,000 years ago, as the Bible explains to us so clearly. And the fact is that the power of death was taken from him. He was wounded in his head. He does not have the power he used to have. And Jesus rained down on him, and it was a secret. God made it a secret. The Bible says, had the devil known who really Jesus was, he would have never crucified him. So I want to tell you something. You're in a battle right now. Because the devil is mad out of his mind. He's furious. He hates the cross. He hates Easter. He hates resurrection. But most of all, he knows that God's people are in store for a blessing and that God is going to pour out a double portion. So make yourself get persistent to receive it right now. Jesus was that way, and Jesus was in the same thinking as you and I are when it comes to where he was. Now today in the setting of, we read it from the book of Mark, it's also in the book of Matthew, it's also in the book of Luke, the setting in which Jesus went to Jericho. Now Jericho is at the bottom, if you go to the Middle East, Jerusalem is at the top of a hill. If you leave Jerusalem, you go straight down. In fact, you go almost and just a little farther south, not far, maybe about 5 or 6 miles, is the lowest place on the earth. So Jericho is in the valley of Canaan, in that area there. And Jericho is full of palm trees. It's called the Moon City. And it is called the Fragrance City, and it is also called the Praise City. Now, the Fragrance City comes because it's so agricultural, and the palms and the moon just simply means that it is a wonderful experience to be in Jericho because it is a pleasant, wonderful, peaceful place. It also means praise because when Israel came to the promised land, the first city was Jericho. And for you that may have read the Bible or for you that have heard about it, you know that 2 million people marched around the city of Jericho 7 days. They marched around it one time every single day, but on the seventh day, God required that they march around it 7 times. And the Bible says on the 7th time, something happened. Now I want you to note that on the 7th day, when they were marching around, when they got around 3 times, 2 million people really marching, and everybody's marching all day long. 4th time, nothing happened. 5th time, nothing happened. You know that people were getting impatient, saying, why are we doing this? And somebody would say, be persistent. God is going to give us a city. Well, my legs hurt, and I've been standing in line, and it's hot out here. And it wasn't bad Monday when we only walked it 1 time. It wasn't bad Thursday when we walked it 1 time. But today, we're walking around this place 7 times. When they got to the 5th time and the 6th time, there was some people that wanted to drop out. Nothing was happening. There was no cracks in the walls. There was no evidence. There was nothing. But the Bible said when they completed the 7th time around, on the 7th day, God opens up the earth and the walls of Jericho go down into the ground. And the Bible said they take the city. Now, you don't have to fire one shot, drop one bomb. All you have to do is be persistent and obedient to God. And God's about to give you your dream, your city, your opportunity, your money. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but there's a breakthrough in this 30, 40 days. And you're struggling right now. I'm talking to some struggling people right now. You're struggling, and maybe in your marriage, your money, job, whatever. But let me tell you something. Something big is about to happen. Now, when we go through these emotional states, of these opportunities, we must be persistent. One scripture in the Bible, in the book of Peter, says, stir your gift up. Many people are saying, oh, God, stir me. Oh, God, speak to me. God, please do something. When the Holy Spirit, through the book of Peter in the New Testament, says there's times in our life we got to stir our own self up. Oh, talk to me now. We got to stir our own self up. That means when you don't feel like being happy, you're happy. When you don't feel like loving your neighbor, you love them anyway. When you don't feel like talking, you talk anyway. When you don't feel like being hospitable, you are hospitable anyway. When you don't feel like raising children, and trust me, when they get to be teenagers, you want to retire right then and there. And then when they don't have jobs in their 20s and you're still dealing with them, you're wondering, are you my kid or not? And the persistency of dealing with all the challenges. Then they get married, and then you find out that the son-in-law doesn't like you like your daughter or your son likes you. And there's challenges that he eats different, she eats different, she does things different. And then their parents, oh, they're different too. And everybody is trying to adjust and et cetera. But if you don't have persistence, and you will find that your worst enemy are the people around you that say, why don't you just give that up? But if it's a burn within you with your faith, make up in your mind, not gonna let anybody stop me. I'm going for my dream, my house, my job, my scholarship. I'm gonna be healthy. I'm gonna get this fat off. I'm going to say that again. I'm going to, whatever it takes, I'm going to get this fat off. Now, some of you love your fat. Good. Be fat. Be fat. Because there's a whole clothing market that needs to sell big clothes. But if you want to live long, you have got to say no to donuts and potato chips and you've got to drive by White Castles and Shoops and say, Jesus, help me, Lord. You've got to be disciplined, but it takes persistency. It takes persistency to look good. Anybody can smell. Anybody can look bad. You don't have to shave. You can stink. You can have wrinkled clothes. You can have an old car. You can have old shoes. But it takes persistency to polish your shoes, to make sure your pants are ironed. It takes persistency to get some Old Spice for 69 cents from Walgreens and put it underneath your arm. It takes persistence to say, I'm gonna smell good and put a mint in my mouth so I don't make people faint when I talk, when I open up my mouth. It takes, come on somebody now. It takes persistence. And we get to an age that we think that we retire from all of those things. You will never retire. As long as you live, God has got you on this earth not to be just going through the motions, but to rise up and to say, I'm alive and I'm alive for a purpose. If nothing else, I'm going to give the devil hell and I'm going to pray for my children and pray for my friends and I'm going to get involved. Persistence. And nobody makes it to the top without persistence. And if you think there is a free ride, there is no such thing. You've got to be persistent. Persistent in your attitude. Persistent in your work schedules. Persistent in your prayer. Persistent. Jesus is going through the same thing. He's 30 days out and nobody really knows what's getting ready to happen to him. The only one that knows is God in him. The devil, listen, the devil doesn't even know that in about 35 days, Jesus is going to be arrested. His friends are going to forsake him. Judas is going to kiss him. Judas is going to sell him for 30 pieces of silver. And the slaughtering is going to begin. All of this that Jesus went through and what we experience reading was written in the Old Testament. Jesus knew because in the Bible, in the Old Testament, Jesus studied the Old Testament. Jesus went to the synagogue. He listened to the priest. They would preach when Messiah comes. They will pull his beard. It's in Isaiah. He read how that the rabbi would say, when Messiah comes, they will forsake him. He read in the Bible, it says it right in the Old Testament, in prophecy, they will pierce him with nails. He will die on a cross. They will beat him. In Isaiah, the prophet said, he is like a lamb led to the slaughter. Now he's in this position, he's about 35 days out. In fact, it's this weekend, it's about approximately this weekend that he goes to Jericho because it's in the bottom, very bottom in the valley there in Canaan. It will take him about 20 days to climb the mountain, get to Bethany, stop here and there, and then he'll get there by Palm Sunday, and then he'll ride in on a donkey. But he knows exactly what's happening. 3.5 years, he's in the half-year stage now, and he knows that what he's about to face is going to be very, very hard. Now, let me jump quickly to Gethsemane and tell you that he's already going to pray a prayer, and that prayer is to his Father, I don't want to do this. I don't want to die. Even though you sent me to be the one to redeem mankind, even though, Father, you sent me so that my blood and my sacrifice, everybody can go to heaven, everybody can be redeemed, everybody can be forgiven, everybody can be a new creature in you. If you go to the garden, you will find that Jesus, in his moments of sweating drops of blood, has started to talk to his Father saying, I want to get out of this. I want to get out of my friend betraying me. I want to get out of being spit upon. I want to get out of somebody slugging me in the face. I want to get out of the crown of thorns. I want to get out of the beating on my back. I want to get out with the nails in my hands. I want to get out of this. Read it. Father, let this cup pass from me. How does Jesus make it through? The devil doesn't know what's going on. You that are Bible readers, you remember reading. The Bible says the devil, had he had known, he would have never crucified Jesus. Because when Jesus was crucified, he took the keys of death from Satan. He took the sting of death from Satan. He bashed his head in. He took the powers away from him. If the devil had known that, he would have never crucified him. The devil didn't even know really who Jesus was, other than a prophet, a miracle worker. Now his disciples, every now and then, you know, he takes Peter and John and James, and they go to Mount Transfiguration. And they say, oh my God, we need to build 3 tabernacles. This is unbelievable, Jesus. You're incredible. At the same time, Jesus then says to them, we're headed for Jerusalem. When he gets down there in Jericho, he says, we got to climb that hill. We got to climb that mountain. We got to head for Jerusalem. And we're going to have to deal with the high priest. And they're going to, it's going to be persecution. And they're going to kill me. They're going to kill me. He tries to tell them that. You can read this. The Bible said Peter stepped up and said, oh, Jesus, nobody's going to kill you and nobody's going to hurt you. I will stand in the way. They will not touch you. Nobody. And Jesus tells Peter, get behind me, Satan. Get behind me. Peter doesn't understand. He said, hey, Lord, I'm trying to stick up for you. And you're telling me to get behind you. You're telling me not to say those words. Because Peter, he really didn't understand what was happening. The only one that understood what was happening was Jesus. Now, let me tell you, all of you are going to have to walk the walk of Jesus. That there's going to be days nobody understands what you're going through. Your husband, your wife, your friends, even though you might tell them, they still don't get it. It's you laying your head on your pillow at night with the lights out, knowing, facing what is facing you, that you probably can't talk to anybody. And if you do, they don't know what to say to you. You have to walk it alone. That's the reason why the Bible said, though I walk through the valley. It didn't say, as we all walk together in the valley. As I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I cannot fear any evil. You can't wait on anybody else. You've got to get persistent. If you wait and tell somebody else about your problems, they will tell you to quit. They will tell you to stop. They will tell you give up. They will tell you it's not going to work. But the persistent doesn't listen to anybody. But what you feel inside, I will accomplish. I will defeat the enemy. I am going to have a great family. My family will be saved. I will accomplish getting my house paid off. This job will respect me and give me a raise. I am going for it. Do I have anybody in this house that has persistence? Quit belly aching. Quit crying. Quit waiting for somebody to hand you a box of puffs and say, darling, I feel so sorry for you. It's nice to tell your problems to somebody else, but get ready. All they can do is hand you Kleenex and cry with you. What you got to do is you got to get up. You got to stir yourself up. You got to say, I'm going to Jesus Christ of Nazareth. The devil can't help me. The government can't help me. My daddy, my mama, my friend can't help me. But there is one that can stick closer than a brother. God! Persistence. So let's watch Jesus here. Let's get a few notes so that we can get the miracles that we need today. Jesus is going to Jericho. Jericho is a great trade town. It's a bustling place. It's beautiful, roses, gardens, and palm trees, and the fragrance in Jericho is spectacular, and there's a lot of things. But if you will notice in the scriptures that we read to you, most of us, including myself, we focused in on blind Bartimaeus. And what you got out of the scripture verses today, just like I would, if you didn't slow down and really look at it, what you got is Jesus opened up the poor beggar, blind man's eyes, Bartimaeus. But I want to show you something. Let's look a little closer. Jesus is looking for confirmation. What do you mean, Pastor? He knows that when he leaves Jericho, he's got to start climbing that mountain with his disciples. In a couple days, he will stop in Bethany. There's going to be a tragedy there. He's going to go to a funeral. It's going to be one of his best friends that died. And that's not going to be a good situation either. But then Jesus resurrects Lazarus. From there, after Mary washes his feet and they minister to him, he's going to go on Palm Sunday. So this is the Sunday. This is probably the vicinity, as close as we can get. He's in Jericho, headed for the death sentence and why he came. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Now, Jesus tries to be your example. Now, I know immediately everybody is saying, I can't be Jesus. I'm not perfect like Jesus. No, we understand that. But the fact is that Jesus became man to show you how to overcome things being a man. Let me tell you, he was God in flesh. But the Bible said he knew no sin, meaning, and the Bible also says he was tempted in every area. He was tempted with homosexuality. He overcame it. I got more amens over here. Well, what kind of crowd I got over here? Well, what's going on over here? He was tempted with homosexuality. Some dude probably came up to him and said, hey, let's do it. Jesus said, get out of my way. There was probably a woman. Many women. You're handsome. You should be on The Bachelor show. Very good looking. Well, I really can't say he's good looking, as the Bible said he was not good looking. Reading Isaiah, the Bible talks about his parents. I'd like to ask God why he let Isaiah write that. I don't know why he said that about his son, but still there were women that flirted with him and women who, you know, tried to go to bed with him. Well, evidently, you haven't read that far in the Bible where the woman at the well was flirting with him and giving him the what for. And the shakedown. Well, come on, you women know what I'm talking about. A shakedown. And she's getting ready to make the move on Jesus. She's about ready to hug him. She's so aggressive. She's about ready to. And let me tell all you girls, just calm down. Quit chasing boys. Stop that. Well, Pastor, you don't understand. I'm hot. I'm just so fully hot. And I'm looking for something that'll. Just calm down. Get persistent of the fact that you were made, and there's a man somewhere looking for you. For the Bible says, if a man looketh on a woman, or if a man findeth a wife. So just calm down, women. Calm down. It's coming. It's happening. You don't understand. I'm 40. He still hasn't showed up. Well, thank God, because if he had showed up, he would have given you hell for the last 20 years. The right one's coming. He's going to pay your bills. He's going to love you. He's going to take you around the world. He's going to be your Prince Charles. Just wait. It's coming. And every single woman here today, I want to tell you, there's somebody looking at you right now, and there's somebody saying, I think she'd be a good wife. You haven't met him. You haven't seen him. I know you're going with somebody, and I know you probably got a ring on, and I hope it's him. But be persistent in the fact that the scripture has already prophesied over you and said somebody's getting ready to find you regardless of age. I'm not getting any amen, so I'm in hot water here or something. But this woman, she's hot too. She wants to go to bed with Jesus. See, that messes everybody up. They put Jesus over here like he can't do anything wrong. He never was. Bible said he was tempted in every area. She's starting to put the move on Jesus. She comes up real close. No, man, she comes up real close. Jesus, you are, woman, just want to tell you, you got five husbands. Or you had five husbands. And the one you're living with is not your husband. She backs up. Who are you, dude? What is it? And of course, the Bible said there was conversion that took place, meaning that Jesus had temptations. He was tempted. The Bible said he was tempted in every which way. Tempted to lie, tempted to steal, tempted to kill. I mean, he had temptations to kill. You ever had a temptation to kill somebody? See, you're all lying. Every one of you have wanted to kill somebody. Thank God it was only in your mind. And not with a gun or something else. Because temptation is in your mind. This always messes with people's minds when I say this. Temptation is not a sin. See how quiet it is? If temptation is a sin, Jesus was a sinner. The Bible said he was tempted in everything, but he never sinned. You can think it. It's just when it gets in your heart, you start doing it. Everything starts up here in the temptation zone of the mind. And in the mind is when all the plots begin to happen. All the stuff, you know, it begins to happen. Adultery, fornication, drugs, gangs, killing. It's all up here. That's the reason why the Bible said, renew your mind. Renew your mind and cast that temptation out. Just because you think it doesn't mean you're a sinner. Just because a man looks on another woman and says, oh, wow. Or he gets on his computer and he accidentally gets into pornography and he has the opportunity to keep going and to keep embellishing in that until it'll get in his heart and it will ruin his life. But you have the ability to say, no. I'd like to hear somebody say that real loud. No. No. I'd like for you to say it with persistence. No. No. Everybody say no when I say to you. Why don't you kill somebody?
No.
Why don't you hate somebody?
No.
That's the persistence. Quit blaming the devil. The devil made me do it. No. You did it. The devil may have come with the pressures of the temptation. So Jesus was tempted in every which way. He's in Jericho. He really needs to be encouraged. Because the only way that he's going to be able to make it through this crisis, the crisis that I'm talking about is Calvary, is that he is going to have to get some joy somewhere. And I want to tell all of you something. You can't make it through life unless you get some joy. That's right. That's about 60% of you. The rest of you don't have any joy. I'm giving it to you right now. Lock the doors. I'm going to get it to you. I'm going to drench you in it. I'm going to hose you down with joy. The fact is, the Bible said the joy of the Lord is your strength. You'll never make it through any crisis unless you have joy. Sometimes you just got to laugh when you're going through hell. You got to sit in the rocking chair and say, is that the best shot, devil, you can get? Ha, ha, ha. Your joy gives you strength. You keep milligrabbing, you lose your persistency, you get down, and everybody's bad, everybody's no good, etc. It drains you down, 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 and you have no strength. When you have no joy, you're critical, you're negative. You talk about everything that's bad. When somebody says, isn't it a good idea that we do that? No, it's not. You cut them off because you have no joy. Joy is what gives you strength. Joy is what says, I can do this. You cannot say these words, I can do all things through Christ, without joy. And even though it hurts, even though it's painful, even though the doctor's report is bad, even though she walked out on you, even though the child is messed up, you still have got to say, I'm telling you, I'm going to be persistent. I'm going to joy up. I'm going to win this battle. I'm going to win. Somebody shout, I'm going to win. Jesus is in this predicament at this time. I'm going to prove it to you. We already know that the Bible says in Hebrews that the only way he made it through the pulling of his beard, the crown of thorns on his head, the nails in his hands, beating his flesh until they pulled the intestines out of his body, slugged him in his face, spit on him, and he was led to the slaughterhouse like a lamb. The Bible says the only way he made it through that is he set joy before him. How do I do that? You need to set your dream before you. Even though you're bankrupt, disgusted, broke, nothing's happening, start dreaming about what God's getting ready to bring in your life to create joy. You got it? So you had a bad day. The sale was bad. Everything is rejected. Nothing is going good. You don't get a good report. You still have got to say, yet, I'm going to do this. So, you know, I have fallen off the wagon. Fallen off the wagon in my exercising program. 3.7 miles, four times a week. I fell off the wagon. I haven't done it in a while. That's the reason why my suits are tighter. But they won't be tight for long. And I don't need any suggestions because I've already made up my mind in persistence. Even though that my wife did say a few weeks ago, Melody said, hey, you're carrying some stuff there, aren't you? And she'll tell you. I think last week I told her, you'll never say that to me again. You will never utter those words to me again. And it motivated me to be persistent. And I never dreamed how hard it was to get back to doing 1 mile. When I got nearly a mile, my body said, you're dead. It's done. It's over. Let's go home. There's a donut waiting for you. Sit down. Everybody else gets fat. You might as well get fat too. And I told my mind with persistence, you fat slob, you no good belly, you potato chip, you french fry, you Dunkin' Donut cheater, sneaking through the window and grabbing him, thinking nobody will know, but then you expose me. And when I got done the other day doing 2.5 miles, getting it back, and by next week at the end of the week, it'll be 3 miles, I get it back, and 3.7, get it back. I don't have anybody clapping their hands when I'm
Oh my God, you got to be persistent. I will be in good health. I will not lose my mind. I will not be in a hospital at 90. I am persistent. I got a dream. I know where I'm going. My grandkids and my grandkids are going to see healthy. I'm going to pass a football. I'm going to be able to play ping pong. I'm going to be able. Come on. Persistency. Now, Pastor, how do you get motivated? I have several suits in my closet. I cannot button. I did this yesterday. I put them close in my closet. I said, I'm going to wear you. And it will be loose between the buttons. Let me just give everybody a forewarning. All of you that don't like to wear suits, you'll get fat. Because you wear these loose clothes all the time, you don't know what you weigh. You keep putting on that size 42, that thing starts, But you wearing sweats, suits and big clothing, you never know. So I check every week. Every week is checkup for me. I'm just talking about me. Now you don't have to do this. It's all right. It's all right. Ever what size you want to be, that's great. That's wonderful. I'll pray for you. Oh yeah, I will. Your poor knees are screaming, please give me a break. I'll pray for you. But it takes persistence. It takes that ability to say, I'm not going to let anything stop me. I'm going to do this. So let me prove to you that Jesus is in Jericho, and it is his last crusade. It's not his last miracle, but it is one of the miracles that are last. He's 35 days away from crisis, and he knows the crisis. He really wants to go to Jericho because he wants the praise. He wants the victory. But I want to show you something. In the passage, the Bible says that the blind Bartimaeus, the Bible says that he said something. He said, Son of David. He said, Jesus, Son of David. Say it with me. Jesus, Son of David. Now, no one had said that to him in the 3.5-year ministry. They said he was a rabbi. Peter said, thou art the Son of God. They said all kinds of things, but they never said Son of David. You can't say Son of David over somebody unless you get arrested by the religious law of Moses. Son of David means you confirm that person to be the Messiah. And you are very dangerous, especially when they didn't know who the Messiah was, that anybody that would utter that, they would arrest you. They would say, you cannot say that. Only Caiaphas or the high priest can administer who is the Messiah. So Jesus had heard a lot of things in 3.5 years. But there's something that Jesus wants to hear. Now we know that his father, his stepfather, Joseph, wanted at 12 years of age, you read about it in the Bible, at 12 years of age, he went to the Passover. Why did he do that? He went to his bar mitzvahs. All Jews at 12 go to a bar mitzvah. What's a bar mitzvah? The father takes the oldest son, or the son when he turns 12, takes him to a bar mitzvah, and the father crowns him, the father acknowledges him, and the father of the son that's 12 years of age, he gives him the confidence, you are now a man. When Joseph and Mary went, watch me, hang with me now. Joseph and Mary were going to Jerusalem. Joseph must have had a conversation with a 12-year-old Jesus. Now you know Jesus, this is your year for bar mitzvahs. We're taking you to the Passover. But I can't take you to the grand finale in the streets where all the 12-year-olds are going to be crowned and you will be confirmed. I'm not your daddy. I can't lie. I can't tell the rabbi, this is my son, confirm him. So Jesus lives for 30 years with no confirming. from his father.
Ah, you're not getting this.
Meaning that whatever you're going through in life, even when somebody doesn't confirm you, there must be a persistence to say, somewhere at some time, I will be confirmed. And when he went into the waters of baptism and John baptized him, God said, this is my beloved son. And Jesus said, I've been waiting 30 years for my daddy to say that. But daddy or nobody has said, even though he knew who he was, he's word manifested in the flesh, he's a God man. Nobody in the 3.5 years had said these words, son of David, because that would confirm him to be the Messiah, and you don't do that. Nobody does that. He goes to Jericho. We read of two men, blind Bartimaeus and Timaeus. Bible said that they are beggars. They're beggars outside of Jericho. To show you how poor they were, let me play you a song to show you how poor they were. They were broke, broke, broke. Flat, busted, and broken. They were broke. Did everybody get that? They're broke. They're beggars. Watch the sequence here, because this will happen to every one of you. Jesus is announced to go to Jericho. Now he's a rock star. Hundreds and thousands of people after 3.5 years. He's 35 days from crucifixion. He moves into the city of Jericho, and the Bible says in one gospel, he went by blind Bartimaeus, and Timaeus was his daddy. They wore clothing because most people thought that those two, if not every blind person, was cursed. It was in the minds of people under the law of Moses, if the daddy was blind and the son was blind, there's a curse on these two. They wear a garment to let everybody know, I'm blind and I'm cursed. The Bible says that Jesus passes them. There's hundreds and hundreds of people. The roar is like a Super Bowl roar. They're passing Jesus and they go into Jericho. Blind Bartimaeus, even though he's blind, somewhere with his persistence in the handicap zone of the church service he would sit in under the rabbi at the synagogue where they put outside the handicap, put together when he would preach the rabbi, when he comes. And he quotes Isaiah, when Messiah comes, the blinded eye shall be open, the lame shall leap like deer, the deaf will hear, the dumb will speak, every valley will be exalted, every mountain will be made low, every crooked place will be made straight, and every rough place will be made smooth. Handicap in the back, cursed, a veil, not allowed in the sanctuary of the synagogue. Blind, but can't get it out of his head. head when Messiah comes. You ever seen blind people? When they get excited, this is kind of what they do. He's sitting outside Jericho. Jesus has just moved by and he's asking, as he's begging, hey, what's going on? Somebody just looks at the cursed man and says, Jesus, you know, the guy that does all the miracles. And someone begins to tell him all the miracles. He walks on water. He's even called back the dead. And he opens blinded eyes. Can you imagine blind Bartimaeus? How could I let him get by? How could I let him pass me? Blind Bartimaeus must have been praying. Let him come out the same gate he came. And in his spirit, he became so persistent. He planned everything out in his mind. He comes out that gate. Oh, if he comes out that gate, I'm going to do it. They may kill me, but I'm going to do it. Because he must be the one. He must be Messiah. I will scream from the top of my lungs, Son of David. Son of David, I will do it. I'm not afraid. Jesus comes out of the gate. He hears the roar. The cry starts. He's coming out. Blind Bartimaeus stands up. The crowd is gathering. Blind Bartimaeus starts screaming, Son of David, have mercy on me. Notice the Bible says, they came to shut him down. Shut up. You can't call him Messiah. You're not allowed to call him Messiah. But ladies and gentlemen, it took a blind man to see who he was. He is the Alpha. He is the Omega. He is the beginning. He is the end. He is the first. He is the last. He's the Rose of Sharon. Shut up. Shut up. But for the first time, after 3.5 years, Jesus hears, Son of David. And Jesus gets excited. Who is saying that? I've been needing that so I could die for the world. May I tell you, whether you know him or not, that when you call his name, he will stand still. For the Bible said he stood still. He said, bring him here. The same people that told him to shut up, God used to bring him here. Ladies and gentlemen, do not lose your persistency. Stand to your feet and shout hallelujah. One more thing. Everybody watch. When they came to him, after they said, shut up, they said to him, he calleth for you. I want to say to somebody in the balcony on the floor who's watching me, this morning, he's calling you. Watch the persistency here. He's calling you. The Bible said when you heard it says, son of David, the Bible said Jesus stood still. Bring him here. One more thing. Jesus can't do it. Your friend can't do it. God can't do it. You have to do it. What did he do? What did he do before he went to Jesus? Bible said he took off the very thing which everybody knew he was blind. I say today, take off your bankruptcy. Take off your sickness. Take off your failures. Take off your divorce. Take off your past. Because I'm not coming back no more. I'm not coming back no more. I'm not going back. Who am I talking to today? I'm not coming back no more. The most startling revelation. The most startling revelation is that when he gets to Jesus, his faith and persistency stands right in front of Jesus. And I'm going to tell you what I believe. He did not have his problem on. He had already taken it off. Jesus had to ask him, what do you need? But had he wore his problem, Jesus would have known what he needed. But when you come to Jesus, you gotta come saying, it's over, I win. The victory is mine. Who am I talking to today? Jesus said, what do you want? Heal my eyes. And here's what Jesus said, because of his persistency. Your faith, not mine. Your faith, not mine. My faith had nothing to do with what's getting ready to happen to you. Your faith will make you whole. I challenge every person under the sound of my voice. Don't you dare give up. Jesus is standing still for you. It will happen. It's going to happen. Can you shout with joy? It is going. So. I hear Jesus now say, Steve, yes. And by the way, I want everybody to know, I hear from God. And I'm hearing him right now. Sister Jackson came a few weeks ago in the wheelchair. I pushed her in the wheelchair. Anybody here on Wednesday night? I pushed her in the wheelchair in front of everybody. I said, she'll be healed. And I said, she'll be healed in 17 days. Well, I'll never preach again. On the 17th day, baby, she didn't only get healed. She got transferred to heaven. And all of you that can't clap your hands, you need to know something. There's no hospitals in heaven. There's no sickness in heaven. He heals you on this side of life. Anybody want to go to heaven early? Come see me. Did you know that, Pastor? Absolutely not. But when Jesus stands still and said, I'm going to heal, and he did. So Jesus says to me, Steve, I just stood still. I mean, I'm up here in the front, Steve. Tell every person in this house that whatever they're going through, to take it off where they're standing. And tell them to walk to me. Tell them not to worry about anybody else. I'm about to do something that's never happened in their life. Because today they have come with persistency. And I don't know who you are, what you need. First timer, member, whatever. But on the count of three, Jesus is about to do something for that person that says, I'm going with persistence. And I'm going to get what I need today. And I have a prayer. When I count to three, Jesus is here. He's standing still. He's telling me, Steve, go get them. Go get them. In the balcony, underneath the balcony, them watching. They're streaming. Go get them, television. Go get them. Today's the day. Today is the day. When I count to three, whether you're a first timer or whether you attend or whether you're a member, it does not matter. When you come, there's a prayer that's going to be prayed, and God is going to send you out of this place, and your life, it will be different. Your miracle's going to happen. Counting now quickly, quickly. One, two, three, come. All over the building. Sing.
Wednesday night, I'll be here. Everybody at the front.
all by the streaming audience, which is the biggest altar, in the living rooms, in the cars. It's a big altar all the way to Austin, Texas, and Miami, Florida. This altar goes all the way to California and into India. I want you to say these words, because Jesus stood still. He's getting ready to do something for you. So say this out loud everywhere. Say, Lord Jesus,
if
there's anything in my heart
should not be there,
forgive me.
Forgive me.
Give me a clean heart.
Give me a clean heart.
Renew my mind.
Renew my mind.
Jesus.
Jesus.
I know.
I know.
Who you are.
Who you are.
You are God.
You are God.
You are my Father.
You are my Father.
You love me.
You love me.
And you're standing still.
And you're standing still.
And I'm right in front of you.
Right in front of you.
This is what I want.
This is what I want.
Now Jesus.
Now Jesus.
Is getting ready. Here it comes. Lift your hands. Lift holy hands. It's all right. All over. All over America, wherever you might be, you in this altar. Now begin to just say, I love you, Jesus, and I'm going to pray. It's coming. The miracle is now going to be released in your life. Sing it as I pray right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, receive it. It's yours. Singing, holy. And when you sing, does the miracle. Open your mouth in the next 1 minute and watch Jesus take your praise and fill you with what you're going to believe Him for. Ready? Let's go. Let's sing this song. Here we go.
I will not stop.
I will not stop.
I believe.
I believe.
Jesus' name.
In Jesus Christ.
I love you dearly. Melanie and I love you dearly. If you'd like for your name to be on the cross, I'm going to nail it Wednesday night. Put your name on a card. The elders are in front. They have a pen. If you'd like to do that, join the church, whatever. God bless you. See you Wednesday night.
Holy, holy forever.
It's 2024. Here we are now, as we have heard this word, this very special word that has touched your life. And I am believing that this word was specially for you. When I think about that, we are just days away from doing the very first performance of Jesus of Nazareth. The hundreds and the hundreds, children, families, behind the scenes, the makeup and the costumes and the building of the sets, the animal ministry that has nearly 100 involved in getting the animals, bringing them to the site of Family Christian Center, the ushers, the traffic control, all that are involved, and even you that are involved, I want to tell you, it's here. In just a few days from today, just a few days, the very first performance in the premiere of Jesus of Nazareth. You know, it comes quick, and then while we're doing, it just quickly starts happening. Every Saturday in the month of March, and I might say that as I am recording this, I have been told just as of yesterday, as I'm speaking, the sales have tripled and quadrupled. The performances are filling up and people are rallying to say, I want to see the greatest story ever told. It's the largest cast we've ever had, and it's the 50th year, and it is going to be great. Come celebrate with us. Come see the new that we have put in the 50th year. Call, get your tickets today. Go online, get them quickly. I want you to see it. I don't want you to call and say, we can't get tickets. Get them today. The investment and the desire to see his story will please Jesus, but it will also minister to you. Here's another thing. Get tickets for someone that's never been to Family Christian Center. Get tickets to someone who has never seen Jesus of Nazareth. Let us spread the word. Let us invest in people to get them saved, to touch their lives. You know, God would be so moved that if you bought a ticket or tickets that you could give to someone and say, go see Jesus of Nazareth. What a way to soul win. There's a man in our church, and he buys 150 tickets a year. He gives them to underprivileged children. He not only buys the tickets, he gets the bus, he gets the transportation, and brings them from South Chicago to see Jesus of Nazareth. One man just does that, and his heart is overwhelmed, and his testimony is incredible. It's done it year after year. He said it has changed the lives of gang members, of children who don't have fathers, never have a chance. And when they get back on the bus after they see that story, they said they are so moved. He buys those tickets. He buys them. He buys them without a discount. He said it is worth it. Never seen anything like it with animals, three-story sets, 1,000 people operating Jesus of Nazareth. So today, it's less than 2 weeks away. It's right here. Go online today on Sunday and buy those tickets. And get your seats and get your friends' seats. This is the 50th year. And I'll tell you, it will change. It will inspire. It will do great things in your life. So, as I go off, they're going to show you advertisement of Jesus of Nazareth, and I would encourage you to copy it off of your computer or even the screen you're watching on, or go online to get the pictures and to get the video of the trailer so you can send it to someone and show them, this is what you're going to, this is what you can see, This is what's happening right now. And when it starts to happen, I already know that several performances are completely sold out. And maybe it's because it's the 50th year, I'm not sure, but it is just exploding. And I really want you to see it. You've seen it last year, you got to come back and see it on the 50th year. Be a part of history. And remember that God's going to do a miracle in your life. God is going to do something special. This is the Lent season. We're less than 31 days to the Resurrection Sunday. Let's do something. Let's give up something. Let's give up some seed money to buy a ticket for someone to see Jesus of Nazareth. Let's pray. Let's believe. But let this season be a season of giving to Jesus Christ. And for you that have been touched, let the miracle happen. I'll see you Wednesday night. It's going to be big. We put all the names on the cross. Get your name in. I'm going to put your name on the cross. You don't want to miss that. Wednesday night, we begin to nail your request, and we let the cross down this Wednesday night. Don't miss Wednesday night. I'll see you Wednesday night. And remember, yes, you